Okay, so myself, I'm Sindhil, and like I said, I work for a R&D organization which looks into research and innovation for cellular standardization stuff. And it may look odd, why go here, why you are talking about this here. So so we had been doing a lot of since myself and there are two of my friends who also did the PhD in IIT Madras along with me in the same lab. And we did our research in the same wireless domain. And we had been doing a lot of simulation using MATLAB. And I think most of us during our bachelor days or during our bachelor's degree, we have used MATLAB a lot, right? And then especially in the wireless domain, even though our focus is on a smaller topic, we need to use all other modules to evaluate what is the performance of such an algorithm. So even whether it's talking about a small UE algorithm, I mean receiver algorithm, or you're talking about something in the base station, you're changing it. But it's not just the algorithm that you do a plot and get it, but you need to evaluate such a system in terms of n number of base stations and n number of UEs in the system. And then you're looking at a metric which is at system level. And when I go for these kind of meetings where you talk about, we are looking for this change in the system. They say, okay, how much percentage of gain can you get? Can you get at least 3% or 5% of the gain? If no, then this doesn't go into the system. So to evaluate every small things, we need to look at a larger, big picture of the system. That's why what we thought is, I mean, we have been using this tool in C++ and MATLAB, but we thought, okay, we need to build a simulator that's more easy for someone to write the code. It's not that, I've seen that most of the people in our lab, we barely go beyond MATLAB. I mean, we know that running a code may take 2 or 3 days in a MATLAB system. But then if you write a C code, we may take 1 week to write a C code and then says, okay, there's an error. So we are a bit lazy. I mean, we're not that good at programming like most of the guys here. So we thought, okay, there's a platform that we need where we could reuse the modules that people use it. There's my research component, then I can contribute on a platform where someone else does a MS or a PhD work. He can contribute and then we try to reuse the research module that is used or developed by each different guys in the system. So so before I get into the, so basically in this talk, what I'm trying to see, do is pose the problem that we are seeing, break down and see that what component exactly matches that Go gives me. So like he said that 2 years back, when I was in Samsung, we were trying to do some demonstration, technical demonstration, where we had been, I've been using Qt a lot. And then it's the time when I thought that there's a lot of packet drop, we are not able to simulate a real-time audio signal processing. Then I thought, let me give a try and use Go for it. Then started using Go, and then I found that this is really the tool that I need. Then I thought, okay, let's give it even a harder problem to solve. Then I thought, let's use Go and then build a platform which can simulate larger wireless systems. So to start with the entire problem, let me take a simple example. This is a wireless device that I'm connecting. So this transmits some waveform, it goes to that receiver, right? So it's not specifically telling that this is the only receiver that can receive it. There could be other receivers here. So when I transmit some waveform from an antenna, it can be received from within some coverage area, right? So this is a simple propagation model. But when you look at wireless system, for example, here I have shown a base station which is radiating some waveforms from the antenna. It can, before it reaches the mobile, it goes, hits some buildings, there are trees, there are other buildings. So you get different copies of the same waveform that is transmitted from the base station, right? So we are trying to model that. So this model depends on a lot of factors, whether the mobile is moving, the what is the height of the mobile, how many antennas the mobile has, right? So there are a lot of components involved when you capture this model. So whenever we simulate a wireless system, there are three major components. One is the base station, second is the mobile. When I say base station, there are a lot of modules, right from, say, for example, I'm trying to simulate what is the impact of a particular receiver algorithm if I'm doing an FTP traffic. What if I'm streaming a video and then the user is moving at a vehicular speed, right? So to capture those things, we need to start modeling right from the bits that is generated, goes into encoding part, then it goes whether to a CDMA or a 4G system, and then it goes to the antenna. So there's a base station, then there are a lot of modules in the mobiles. Then in between, what you have is the wireless channel, which I showed earlier. So let's take a simple example. So we are not always simulating one transmitter, one receiver. We are always simulating a case where you need at least 19 cells. Like one cell is one where you see a base station, and then you have a 360 degree coverage, and then each of the cell has at least 3 sectors. So we are looking at least 57 sectors, and then each sector we need at least to have, assume there are 20 active users in the system, right? And then if you see, when a base station is sending a signal or transmitting something, say for example here the signal is for this car, so there may be near other base stations nearby, they also transmit some data for that particular for the users in that coverage area. So basically you start seeing signal and interference from all adjacent base stations. So to capture the true statistics of the signal that you are receiving, you need to model at least the signal and at least 6 interfering signals that is coming from around you, right? So what you see is around 6800, about 700 wireless propagation links has to be simulated, and each of this link is just a snapshot of a data or a waveform that is sent within 1 millisecond. And if I look at the waveform that you do, usually is think of a complex vector, and we have around 14,000 complex samples that you are transmitting within 1 millisecond. So it's about big number of data that you need to simulate at a given time. So there's parallelly there are a lot of transmitter base stations, a lot of UEs in the system, and then there's a large vector of data there you need to process it. Okay, so you have a I said the main components are base station, mobile, and the channel, but then there are a lot of variables in the system. One, whether the user is moving in a system, what kind of terrain he is, for example, he's in a rural area, he's in an urban area, or what kind of propagation model that we are using it, whether he's at a lower frequency, whether he's using a 2.4 gigahertz system, right? And then you have algorithms, different algorithms, and then what does the base station use? Does it use a round robin scheduler? Does it use a professional fare scheduler, right? And then we evaluate different metrics, like what is the average throughput a user gets. Okay, so putting up all these things, we thought let's break the problem. What is it that we are trying to get it? So we are looking at a collaborative platform where each user builds or focuses his development or the code that he does only on the algorithm that he is looking at, right? For example, if I'm building a phone, there's not a single vendor who will make all the chipset needed to build it. So I know that, okay, this vendor, say for example, buy Qualcomm chipset, and then I know someone else is building some other chipset, build them, put together, and then I'm able to make the phone ready. Similarly, we are looking at a case where each researcher or maybe the guy who is focusing on algorithm builds the module, and then we try to integrate them and then try to represent or simulate such a wireless system using those components. Okay? So we have been focusing on this 4 philosophy where we're looking at modularity, like what I mentioned, and then we need to have standardized interfaces. Just like when you buy a chipset, you don't go and ask Qualcomm what is it. They just give a specification. Pin number 1, you need to give the data in, and then pin number 5, you'll get your symbols out. This is the bare minimal specification that you need and what this chip functions, right? So that kind of modularity we would like to bring into the platform. And then easiness, where you could do this modularity stuff even still now when you download a GitHub, some library someone else has written it, download it, and then you look at what are the APIs that he is using, you'll find some other library. But now we are also looking at a case where like I said, most of the guys from the research side, we don't do a lot of coding. We want something which is easy and do it, right? So we are looking at, can I just drag and drop components which are, I know, okay, this is how the codec needs for a CDMA system, build it. And then I focus on only writing the code where I am focusing on, right? So we are looking at how do we generate an automatic code based on connecting these modules. So it will generate a Go code, and then I just execute the Go code which represents that system. And then we have a scalability case, like I have been telling, whatever numbers I told earlier was like 7,000 links just for a single snapshot system. What happens if I want to see, I think US some operators are selling home base stations where a user can buy a personal base station. When there is no coverage, you buy it and put it in your house, right? So it's not just the base station that we are trying to model. What about these personal base stations? People can buy it. If you go into mall, there are smaller base stations inside the mall buildings. So you can just start adding more and more such units or devices in the system. So in that case, you need to be prepared that I can scale up the problem, the simulation should not be restricted to this kind of number, but I am looking at even larger number. So this kind of simulation need not to be only on my desktop. Tomorrow I may run all those systems on the cloud. So this is where we see, like, we are not going to use MATLAB on laptop. I run, take a tab, set up my module, run the code on the cloud. So we would like to have the platform ready for that. And then we have interactability. Maybe I'll come to that part later in the structure. Yeah, so here what we see is, like, yesterday's was one of the talk, Go in Action, where it says, we found a similar thing here. We see Go as a language where we could exactly replicate what happens in reality. And then we are saying that, okay, there is a base station one, there's another base station here. They don't have to talk to each other, hey, my data is ready, my FTP traffic is ready. They don't try to sync each other, right? So they need to ensure that they are syncing only when they are actually transmitting the data into the antenna. Basically, they are having a GPS, they just lock to the GPS signal, have a time that is synced. But anything that goes before transmitting the waveform, they're all not synced, right? So we try to see that we could actually do that in Go, where I just trigger a base station, says this is an independent routine, you start generating the data and wait till all the base stations have done the signal generation. Then I do the part where you're actually combining those signals, right? That is one. And then even if you look inside a base station, so these are, okay. So then we see, for example, this I have dropped down into a very simplest case where you have a data which for each users, and then there is an encoder which data like error correction codes or something like that. And then you have a modem. It takes the bits and then maps to a physical waveform that goes into the antenna, right? So even though they're all connected in sequence, they could actually start processing as soon as the data queue has done its job. It pushes the data to the encoder, and then I can say data queue to start processing the next set of data, right? So there could be still concurrency that we could exploit even implementing the components of the transmitter, right? So this is similar even, for the receiver case. So we saw two cases, two components. One is the transmitter side, where you have this kind of blocks, right? And then you're trying to bring in concurrency in the modules. And then the third part is the channel. So yeah. So when you have this kind of models, we use Go channel. I mean, this is known, I don't want to beat the same thing again. So we use Go routines, Go channel, and when I see these features in Go, I found this is exactly what we need to simulate such kind of system. So we thought, okay, let's look at this. So we thought the basic component that we need to have is a chipset which will represent a module which is close enough and which is independent, ready enough to run as a concurrent module. So if I say that this chipset which is just doing a modulation build in, and then I just connect the bits in, it should start processing, right? So I could I model the smallest component as a chipset, okay? And then so the beauty of Go which I liked about is the interface. So I am not saying that I don't define a structure which is modem. I just define any chipset which has these features. For example, if I buy a chip, I know that this is a chipset by looking at, okay, you should know how many number of pins they are, what does each pin mean, that's what I need. And then I can start using it. So we define a chipset interface, which is, there's nothing special here. Especially we look at loading the configuration of chipset just by using a JSON file. Drag and drop stuff and then say, this is the configuration. Which will represent a CDMA system or a CDMA transmitter, loads the JSON, and then it can reconfigure the chipset, and then I can start connecting the different chipsets in the system. So use Go channel to connect those things. Like we have a, usually what we send is not just the data vector, but we also have some metadata that we're sending. And there are some state-based, usually when we do it, either we do event-driven programming or we do either sequential programming. So here we also try to bring in a case where you can send commands to the following chipsets. Say there is an FTP layer which tells the one which is at the bottom, saying that, okay, the third frame should be transmitted at a higher power. I just have to put in a message along with the metadata saying this particular command is directed to chipset number 5 or something in the queue, and it looks at the message and says, hey, this is a command for me, I need to execute. So I could all the way trigger a kind of, you can say it's like a pseudo protocol that you can implement, control the chipsets in different layers using the meta information that I'm passing along with the Go channel structure. Yeah, so what we saw is the two component, the base station, how we model the base station and the mobiles. And then the third component was the wireless link. like I said, you have signal and interference that you need to capture when you simulate the signal received by at least one mobile, right? So if you look at the receiver, what we see is a signal which is the green one, and then a lot of other signals transmitted from base stations which are nearby. So each of the transmitter and the receiver need not to have a similar same propagation models, because when I see from this side, there may be sub-meldings. When I see at this side, you will see the propagation is different, right? So what we do is we actually can parallelize, or you can run these model, that the green one, all these different blocks in a concurrent fashion. And if you look at this block, this is very closely representing MapReduce algorithms, where we take data vector and then you give it to different functions. Once all the functions have finished the work, I need to combine them. So this is exactly similar one that we are doing, right? So what we see is most of the things are closely resembling some of the things that software engineering components or some of the algorithms are used. So we try to reuse those things. And then this is about single receiver. Now if you look at a big picture, where I said there are a lot of base stations, lot of receivers, this is what it happens. This is where we see the biggest challenge that we are looking at, where you have a lot of base stations, lot of users on the other side. UE is user equipment, basically it's a standard terminology. Okay, so we have each, now for example, if you look at UE1 there, right? So it need not to be affected by the transmissions of all the base stations. It may be affected by only some of the base stations. So as soon as the data is ready from these base stations, UE1 can actually start processing the data, right? And then similarly UE2, so all these receivers, they all run concurrently, and they start using, proceeding to the next stage as soon as the data, as soon as it receives the sufficient data that it needs. Okay, so what we do is, you need a manager, buffer manager, which looks at a buffer, which looks at all the input transmit data from all the transmitters. Then there is a buffer manager which looks at the receiver side. As soon as the buffers are filled, and then it says that, okay, now this data is ready for the receiver to process, I start sending it. So this is how it looks, right? So now when I say I'm going to scale it up to 100 base stations, what happens? So I can't expect that all the base stations are still running on the same PC. It may be running on a different virtual machines. I need to have a way of communicating with the base stations or running it on a different virtual machine. And then, like I said, the data that I'm looking at are at 114 or 120 kilobytes of data. So at every time, I'm going to send a large chunk of data across a Go channel. Yeah. And then, so this is the buffer that we are looking at. So we have a Go channel buffer. Basically, the source is basically a Go channel which is looking at a complex array of symbols. And then I use a mutex here, which actually looks at, for example, there may be multiple receivers which are affected by a transmitter, but one at a given time, only one of the base receiver can change the state of the buffer. So even though we have channel, this particular flag, the state is managed or controlled using locks. And similarly, we have a receive buffer, which again has a mutex, which is looking at the counter, which says how many data, for example, I am supposed to start processing the data only when I receive all the 6 transmitted signals, right? So I need to wait for all the 6 to transmit. So this is a counter which takes care of it. And we need to synchronize the signals and interference are aligned. I don't want to add a signal that is coming from base station 1, which is sending a data corresponds to frame number 0. And then interference is sending some data which corresponds to frame number 10. I don't want to do it. So I need to have a synchronization across the base stations, which are time aligned. So we need a buffer manager which actually looks at, gives a feedback between the here. So which looks at the feedback between the receive buffer manager and the transmit buffer manager. So this we had to be doing as a after office hour work, not a part of my company stuff. So me and there's another colleague, he also works for a different company, but these are components that we do it on the off hours kind of time. So right now what we have is the state is we have built some core component that you need for a base station, modeling base stations, receivers, right? And then we have a code generation which actually looks at a JSON saying, okay, this is the connection diagram of the chipset that you have. And then let me generate the go code from that, right? So basically, if I give it the code to my new guy who joins the lab, I say, you need to focus on this algorithm, and this is how the circuit looks. He looks at the circuit, he writes the JSON file, and then he says, okay, generate the code. Then the code is ready. He just opens the part where it says this is the function that he needs to implement. So this, I feel, is a way where I could encourage the guys in the lab to start using, okay, I don't have to write a big code now. I have a tool which is ready-made, start using it. And yes, what we lack usually from the Go side is the tools. UI is something everyone who wants a code, look at the code and where's the GUI? How do I pull it and do it? So there is a front-end side, the web front-end, which will actually interact with the back-end, which is doing all this code generation, all the stuff, which we are not expert in the app development using stuff. So that is something which we are looking for interesting people, those who are ready to work with us. We are open to that. And this is an open source project. We plan to do it. And yeah, and then one more thing which I feel to encourage guys to move to Go is I would like to start a new repository which looks at, upload a MATLAB code and then it generates a Go code out of it. So I would like to import MATLAB code and generate a Go code. So Veronica's job will be much easier now. Okay, and then we would like to bring in some of the standardized models that exist in the, for example, if you're taking your results to some meetings or somewhere, they need, okay, are you using exactly these models? So we'd like to bring in such components so that it's not just the academic guys who can use it. Later on, we believe companies can also start using such a platform. They could also use the platform to simulate and then say, okay, this is a trusted result, we can use it. Okay, so I have a small demo of the system. So, okay, this is called a scatter plot. Basically, we are looking at TX from the transmitter. I'm sending some complex symbols. This is a QPSK symbol which has either the real part you have plus minus 1, or in the imaginary part either you have plus minus 1. So here it is normalized to 0.707, basically unit energy symbol. And then what you see is when I, so when the signal goes into the channel, like I said, the channel actually gets a lot of copies. It rotates the symbol that you receive, and then there is noise added to the system. So you look at the system, when you say SNR at 25 dB, that means you are very close to a base station. So your signal quality is very high, right? So at that, so here you could see that all the components, they are actually executing in parallel. They're all output of a concurrent modules in the entire link. So I have three transmitter and three receivers running in concurrent, and then the transmit symbol is same across all the transmitters. But at the receiver side, you see one of the link, it's a very high SNR case, 25 dB. The transmitted S1 is this blue one, and what you see there, the red one is around that. I mean, the signal has got rotated, or it's just rotated by certain angle, right? And then if you look at the same case down, the signal is not rotated, but what you see is just an additional noise added to that. So it's the same location, but you see, instead of what you receive plus 0.707 or something, you see some additional noise around the same detected point. And then here you see the SNR is at 10 dB. That means I'm a bit far away from the base station, so you have more noise with respect to the previous system. So whatever you transmit, you see the symbols are more away from the actual signal that you're receiving. So you could see that at every frame, I can concurrently see all the modules are operating at the time. So this is a small step. We believe case that we wanted to build up is like when you take a problem, it's not the language that we choose and then say, okay, with this language I want to build a web app. So I see most of the people here, we have been using Go as a tool for web app and backend processing, but we found the other way where we took a problem, then we thought, okay, this is what a real system looks like and this is the language which suits to use it. So I came to Go from the other side, right? So that's the thing which makes me interesting. So I thought, okay, this is a place where it will give a different feel of the Golang, and maybe it will also encourage some of the students to say to their friends that stop MATLAB, let's start using Go even for your lab assignments and all those things. Okay? And open source, not like MATLAB. Okay, you're done. So you could reach me on Twitter handle. I am SSK, Arun Iyer, and Estudios. So these are three of us. Thank you.